नमस्कार प्रोफेसर चंदन बालाजी, नमस्कार। मेरी आवाज आ रही है आपको? आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है। हेलो
सर, एम आई ऑडिबल नाउ?
हाँ, यस
ओके सर। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन।
Good afternoon to everyone present here.
Sir, as all of us are aware that the entire world community is celebrating the Human Rights Day today, the day of the rights of an individual who is at the root to all laws, whether it is municipal law or international law. On this eve, we have organized this virtual meet, and I welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is the Chief Patron of this program. I welcome my revered teacher and the former Dean and Head of this very institution, the Faculty of Law, Jainarayan Vyas University, Professor M.K. Bhandari, my all colleagues of the Faculty of Law, my dear students who have joined this meeting, and all other who have joined this meeting. I heartily welcome all of them on this occasion. Professor Bhandari will deliver his speech on human rights during COVID crisis, issues and challenges for India, which is a very relevant and current topic in the present scenario. But before we will speak on this very current topic, I would like our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to address on this occasion. So please, I request Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to address us on this occasion.
ऑडिबल नहीं है मैम। डीन मैडम,
यस सर,
वॉइस इज नॉट कमिंग।
या सर, सर ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर सर विल स्पीक फर्स्ट।
ओके, सो ही इज कनेक्टिंग।
या
ही इज कनेक्टिंग। ओके,
या ही इज कनेक्ट।
यस, कैसे हैं डॉक्टर निधि? टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम है।
glad to know that Faculty of Law, Jainan Vyas University, Jodhpur is organizing a lecture on human rights during COVID crisis, issues and challenges for India on the occasion of Human Rights Day today. On behalf of the Jainan Vyas University and my own, I welcome the distinguished speaker of this lecture, Professor M.K. Bhandari, former Dean, Faculty of Law, Jainan Vyas University, Jodhpur. My best wishes to Professor Chandan Bala, Dean, Faculty of Law, and Professor Sunil Asopa, and members of seminar committee and all other related technical persons for organizing this event on Human Rights Day. I am sure that the lecture given by Professor Bhandari will enrich our faculty and participants. Friends, World Health Organization declared a novel coronavirus, COVID-19, a subject of public health emergency of worldwide concern on 30th January 2020. After seeing the rapid growth of infection among people and deaths worldwide, governments were quick to implement a variety of measures to fight the battle with this communities and of individuals. Now is the time for solidarity and cooperation to tackle the effects, often unintended, of measures designed to halt the spread of the virus. With COVID-19, a fast-moving and global health crisis has collided with many slower and more entrenched political, social, and economic crises around the world. Those multiple underlying fractures which have made us more vulnerable to this virus and create entry point for its harms results from gaps in human rights protection. In order to navigate this pandemic in security, we need more empowerment and more participation by civil society. We need to build up human right-based systems to protect and cherish the people who are the greatest resource of any country and the only bottom line that really counts. We need to devise policies that are grounded in right, democracy, and rule of law so that we can minimize the devastating social, economic, and humanitarian consequences of COVID-19 and build back societies that are resilient and fair. Better health is a necessity for a better life and key to happiness and well-being. India is a member of the International Covenant of Economic, Social and Human Rights. It specifically deals with a person's right to enjoy the highest achievable mental and physical health. Hence, the government should take a proper initiative for providing adequate health services of superior quality, and satisfactory medical care should be given to people to prevent threats to public health. However, a lot of work is still required to be done. According to India's largest national survey of June 2018, only about 10% of the poorest 1/5 of Indian in rural and 9.8 urban Indian had any form of health insurance, which concludes how lack of money impact health. This type of discrimination should be stopped and all people should be treated equally. Right to health is a fundamental right. I am happy that Professor M.K. Bhandari will deliver his speech on this important theme. Certainly, the students and the teaching fraternity and other interested persons will be benefited by it. I congratulate the Faculty of Law for organizing such a discourse. My best wishes to organizers. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat. Thank you all.
Namaskar, sir.
Yes, sir, Bhandari, sir, now you can start, sir.
Hello.
Sir, I invite you, sir, to deliver your speech.
Honorable the Vice Chancellor, Professor Trivedi, sir, Dean, Faculty of Law, Dr. Chandan Balaji, Professor Sunil Asopa, Dr. Meena, Dr. Dalpat, Dr. Nidhi, and all other my faculty colleagues who are here in the meeting room, and dear students. First of all, I extend my greetings on this International Human Rights Day to all of you, and let us rededicate our efforts for strengthening the human rights values in India and in our society. I also congratulate Professor Dr. Chandan Balaji, who has very thoughtfully organized this program and remembered me to share my thoughts on a contemporary and challenging issues of human rights during COVID crisis. Friends, let me briefly share with you the whole global concept of human rights. Although we are accustomed to the concept of human rights from Western lens, from Western perspective, that is the Magna Carta, we start from Magna Carta 1215, then we come to French Revolution, American Bill of Rights, then we come to Universal Declaration of Human Rights, that is known as the modern charter, the declaration supported by socio-economic covenant and other what we call Bill of Human Rights. But I invite your attention to the Indian socio-cultural and religious ethos, wherein we always believe that sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani paschanti, ma kaschit dukh bhag bhave. I always think that can there be any comprehensive, all-inclusive explanation or concept of human rights than these four lines, where we wish good for all, we wish health for all, we want that nobody should suffer. Now, in this background, if we look to the human rights scenario in current challenging times, we find that COVID-19, almost 1 year has passed, we are living with this extraordinary conditions where the in whole of the world, as per latest figure, nearly 6.94 crore people are infected and almost 15.7 lakh people have died. And if we talk in India, it is close to 1 crore people and who are infected, who have been infected, and close to 1.4 lakh people who have died. This is really a great challenge to the human survival. And this issue is not just of human survival, but it is an issue of mass scale, global violation of human rights in various dimensions. Before that, let me share with you a, please make me co-host. I want to share the message of the UN General Assembly Secretary General, who has very rightly said, Antonio Guterres, that it is a human right crisis. Please listen to this short message. Is it visible?
Sir, it is not audible.
Audible.
It's not audible?
Yeah, not audible, sir.
But it is audible at my end.
So you have to turn on audio sharing option.
Just a minute. From where should I make it audio? Is it audible now?
No, sir.
How should I make it audible? It is audible to me. Mujhe sunai de raha hai.
Sir, on left hand side, downside, it is the option is available to turn on audio sharing.
And I think who is suffering most.
Yeah, sir.
What can be done about it? We have seen how the virus does not discriminate, but its impacts do, exposing deep weaknesses in the delivery of public services and structural inequalities that impede access to them. We must make sure they are properly addressed in the response. We see the disproportionate effects on certain communities, the rise of hate speech, the targeting of vulnerable groups, and the risk of heavy-handed security responses undermining the health response. Against the background of rising ethno-nationalism, populism, authoritarianism, and the pushback against human rights in some countries, the crisis can provide a pretext to adopt repressive measures for purposes unrelated to the pandemic. This is unacceptable. More than ever, governments must be transparent, responsive, and accountable. Civic space and press freedom are critical. Civil society organizations and the private sector have essential roles to play. And in all we do, let's never forget, the threat is the virus, not people. We must ensure that any emergency measures, including states of emergency, are legal, proportionate, necessary, and non-discriminatory, have a specific focus and duration, and take the least intrusive approach possible to protect public health. The best response is one that responds proportionately to immediate threats while protecting human rights and the rule of law. Looking ahead, we need to build back better. The Sustainable Development Goals, which are underpinned by human rights, provide the framework for more inclusive and sustainable economies and societies. Strengthening economic and social rights bolsters the resilience for the long haul. Recovery must also respect the rights of future generations, enhancing climate action, aiming at carbon neutrality by 2050 and protecting biodiversity. We are all in this together. The virus threatens everyone. Human rights uplift everyone. By respecting human rights in this time of crisis, we will build more effective and inclusive solutions for the emergency of today and the recovery for tomorrow. Thank you.
Hello. Friends, you have listened to the UN Secretary General's message, which he has delivered on the occasion of release of UN report on pandemic and human rights. And what he has laid emphasis that the action taken to meet this challenge must be proportionate and non-discriminatory. अब तक जो हमने देखा है पिछले एक वर्ष में भारत में भी और पूरी दुनिया में कि किस तरह से कोविड 19 से लड़ने के लिए उसको रोकने के लिए पहले 2-3 महीनों में कंप्लीट लॉकडाउन किया गया, उसके बाद में अनलॉकडाउन की अलग अलग फेजेज चलती रही, बीच में जब कोविड बढ़ने लगा तो फिर लॉकडाउन किए गए अलग अलग पॉकेट्स में, अलग अलग एरियाज में, क्वारंटाइन का एक अलग दौर चला और कंटेनमेंट जोन्स बने। इस तरह से हमने देखा कि कई तरह के प्रयास राज्यों और केंद्र सरकार द्वारा भारत में भी और विश्व के अन्य राष्ट्रों में भी किए गए और उनका उद्देश्य मूल रूप से ये था कि किस प्रकार कोविड के प्रसार को रोका जाए और लोग सुरक्षित रहें और जो भी अगर इन्फेक्टेड हो रहे हैं तो उनका तुरंत इलाज हो, उनकी पहचान हो, ट्रेसिंग हो और उसको आगे बढ़ने से रोका जाए। उद्देश्य निस्संदेह रूप से अच्छे हैं और जरूरी भी हैं, लेकिन आज हम जब मानव अधिकार की बात कर रहे हैं तो हमें ये देखना पड़ेगा कि क्या ये उद्देश्य गंभीरता के अनुरूप थे, संतुलित थे, क्या इससे लोगों के मानव अधिकारों का हनन नहीं हुआ या हुआ और किस प्रकार इनका पालन या एनफोर्समेंट करवाया गया। मैं सबसे पहले आपका ध्यान हेल्थ की ओर ध्यान दिलाता हूं, जैसा कि हमारे कुलपति महोदय ने भी कहा और हम मानते हैं कि जान है तो जहान है। The right to life includes right to decent health and another important aspect is right to dignity. It is not mere animal existence. Supreme Court has said right to life does not mean mere animal existence. Right to life includes right to live with dignity. In that context, if you examine, we find that our health care services are highly insufficient, and this has been exposed when we are meeting with such situation. But again, we have a global experience that country like USA, the world's most powerful country in all respect, the European countries which have the best of the health facilities like France, Germany, Italy, Spain, Brazil, they are the worst sufferers. When it comes to COVID pandemic, US is still number one in infections and death both, despite the fact that they have the best services. If we come back to India, we find that it is the toughness of the people, the better immunity level of the people that could limit or that could control the number of infections and deaths if we compare to the Western countries. If we compare, otherwise there have been large number of deaths and infections, nearly 1 crore we are touching. But our healthcare services have been found very poor, especially in rural areas. Thanks to our doctors and nursing and paramedical staff who have been fighting day and night to provide their services even after putting their own life at risk. But here again, I would like to say that the role of the private hospitals and nursing care and other things has not been very satisfactory. It is only the government doctors and government staff, they have been fighting and they have been providing the necessary treatment and support to fight COVID-19, whereas we have seen the private hospitals have been making money. I'm not going to cast any aspersions, but the fact remains this. Hospitals and doctors would have volunteered that we are ready to offer services in association with the government doctors. It is not the responsibility of the government alone. It's the responsibility of each and every person. Anyway, it is not just a health problem. It is also a great economic distress. We have seen mass exodus of the laborers because they could not find jobs or their jobs were lost. The work was lost. So they had to run to their own home place. And we have seen mass exodus, people in lakhs walking and going to without any proper facilities to their hometown somewhere in the month of June and July. That was a big challenge. There was a larger violation of human rights. Perhaps our governance could not think of or provide necessary support mechanism to those vulnerable sections of the society. Perhaps our system failed to foresee, to guess that how they will sustain this epidemic. The third important challenge is our education system. Since we all belong to the education, and we have seen and we all find that how our academic calendar, our imparting of education has been grossly disturbed. Here I would say, thanks to the technology, thanks to the internet, thanks to the ICT, that we are connecting with each other and we are sharing our knowledge with each other. The online classes, they are becoming possible. But again, here we have to find that due to lack of proper services in remote and village areas, the benefit of online teaching and learning is not available or accessible to all people, all students. As per a global survey, 1.6 billion students are deprived of proper internet connectivity and are deprived of right to education. Right to education, now we have a Article 21A. Earlier also in Mohini Jain's case, the Supreme Court has recognized that right to education is a fundamental right, part of right to life and liberty. But we have not been able to create necessary infrastructure. Now, currently, if you see, recently in cabinet meeting yesterday only, the Prime Minister and the cabinet has decided that the connectivity will be made possible through a nationwide program, PM Vani, under Atmanirbhar Bharat, that all our remote areas, especially the remote eastern states, like Manipur, Nagaland, Lakshadweep, Arunachal Pradesh, they will be properly connected with optic fiber and other connectivities. So this is another area where we have found that there has been lacking. And the right to education, we could not provide equal justice or equal opportunities, as we say that it is fundamental right to equality, Article 14, and right to equality, that we have not been able to sustain. Our focus has mainly in urban areas, and the rural areas, we have not been able to provide necessary support system. Another major problem which is emerging is unemployment, poverty. Poverty is the biggest curse in human life. It's a cause of so many problems. Because of the loss of employment, as per a recent survey, 3 out of every 4 young persons have been suffering from economic crisis, economic stress. You can see around your environment that how the vulnerable people are suffering from loss of jobs, loss of employment, reduction in salaries, non-payment of salaries in time, and so many other issues. So this is another big challenge for the governance, how to address these issues of food security, restoration of economy, education, homelessness, supply of essential commodities, water supply, potable water. So 5 minutes more, or you have upgraded it for extension, let me know so that I can conclude.
Yes, sir, 5 minutes.
Okay. So these are all issues which we have to understand, that how during this extraordinary pandemic situation, these conditions can be improved. Certainly, it is a big challenge, but it is an opportunity where we have to show collectively our resolve to fight this pandemic and also to restore our life pre-pandemic stage. Here, one thing I would like to say, that we have seen that the role of our political masters have been grossly irresponsible. Yes, when I'm saying it, I'm saying with all responsibility. The way in which the political rallies are being conducted, the gatherings are conducted, the recent agitation of Kisan Andolan is being done in these critical times, we are exposing ourselves to great further spread of the COVID-19. And here we need a disciplined approach. Our political leaders, we have seen how the almost 1.5 months, our MLA's elected representatives were enjoying 5-star luxury in the name of the possible threat to the government. Such kind of behaviors are not at all expected in a democracy where the government has to be responsible toward the needs of the society. Anyway, there are many other issues. And let me tell you finally, that when we talk of human rights, we must not forget human duties also. Article 29.1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights specifically says, I quote, "Everyone has duties to the community in which alone the free and development of his personality is possible." So rights and duties go together, and we have to understand that when we talk of rights during pandemics, we must also think how best we can contribute, how we can help our fellow beings who are in our environment and who are suffering. This is how we can strengthen our human rights even during these challenging times. We should not just remain dependent on the state or the government, but we should also play our role. Whatever small role we can do, we must play. And I conclude with this words, at this critical juncture, our shared human conditions and values must be a source of unity, not division. We must give people hope and a vision of what the future can hold. So let us be optimistic, and let us contribute, and let us support each other. With these words, I once again thank Dr. Chandan Balaji and all of you, and wish all of you a happy Human Rights Day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening us and making us sensible and sensitive towards our duties also. Thank you very much, sir.
You can share some pics if you have taken, somebody has taken, can share some pics. So with this, we conclude this meeting.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Am I audible, sir? Thank you, sir.
Yes, yes. Thanks to all of you. Best wishes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining this meeting and making it successful. Happy Human Rights Day to all.